Hello and welcome to video 9 of the Odyssey Draft First Steps tutorial series. In the last lesson, we learned how to create global variables and used scripting to create a reaction point in our Mina Dracula dialogue. This video will be all about templates. We will talk about why we should use templates and how to work with them. We will take a detailed look at how templates are constructed and then update one of the existing templates with an additional property. Let's start with the question, what the benefits are of using templates. We have a widely varied range of game genres spread across PC, console, and mobile. And even within any one genre, games are not simply copies of the same old mold. Every developer brings in unique ideas and tries to find new ways of telling stories. A one-fits-all solution for all the ways to approach game projects is not really an option. It might work for some, but for others it would be far too constraining, and some would not even be possible at all. These are the reasons that led to Odyssey's template feature. With custom templates, you can add your own project-specific properties to any kind of object. Templates enable you to structure your game data in just the way you need it. And this is by no means limited to elements like characters or items. Later in this video, we will take a look at some properties that get assigned to dialogue fragments by a custom template. But first, let's take a look at the building blocks of a template. Templates are structured in a modular approach, which consists of three levels. The first level are single properties. For example, text fields, like we use for our characters to store background, appearance, or motivation. The next level are features. A feature is a set of properties. We group the three text properties into a feature called character info. The third level are the templates themselves. They consist of one or more features. Our character template consists of the character info feature. Templates are assigned to objects. It is important to note that each object can only have one template assigned to it. So why this distinction between feature and template? If there is only one feature in the template, the extra step seems a bit pointless. You're right. For this exact example, it does not seem to make a lot of sense. But let's say a bit further down the road we want to introduce some merchant characters. We could, of course, just add the extra properties we need for the merchants to the character info feature, but that would clutter the other characters with unnecessary data. It is better to group the needed properties, like the money the merchants have and their stock, into a second feature, and then create a new merchant template that consists of the character info and the merchant features. A feature is constructed by combining basic properties, and one feature can be used in multiple templates. It might take a bit of effort to set it up initially, but if you have established your structure, it makes things easier down the road and produces a much cleaner output when exporting the project. But don't worry, nothing is set in stone at this point. We know that a lot of projects undergo some changes during development. So of course you can edit features and templates at a later stage to adapt to that. Now that we have seen how templates are structured, let's go to the template design area in Odyssey and look at some of the property types we can use in detail. Go to Features tutorial and open the Character Info feature. The feature is now displayed in the content area. To be able to edit it, click the Edit button on the right side. We are now in the Feature Editor, which opened in a new window. It is divided into three parts. On the left side, you can find the property list with all basic property types. In the middle, the layout area is located, where the current state of the feature is shown. On the right side, a list of parameters is displayed, divided between feature and property parameters. An important side note here. The naming convention for technical names is the same as for variables. You cannot use spaces or special characters, but you will be informed right away if the name is not meeting the specifications. Let's see which properties were used for this feature. The playable character property is a Boolean property. We already know this from variables. This property can be either true or false. In the parameter area, we can set the default value, which is false in this case. So we only have to touch this property to change the value if we want to make a character playable, like we did with Mina. Number is pretty self-explanatory, but let's add 1 to the template feature so we can take a look at the parameters. Click, hold, and drag to add the property to the layout area. Click it again to select it. Here we are offered more options in the parameter region. In addition to setting a default value, we can also set min and max values. Setting these so-called constraints can be very useful because Artisy can show occurring issues to you, so they can get fixed before they even go into the game engine. Imagine the number property here is supposed to control the damage an enemy can do. Let's say it should range between 10 and 100. While entering the data in the actual entity, a small typo happens, and suddenly this enemy can do 200 points of damage. It could take a long time until this is noticed in testing. With Artisy, things like this do not even make it into the game. Back to the feature. We don't really need the number property, so remove it by pressing the delete key or using the right-click context menu. Next are the text fields. In our feature, we use a small and 3 medium ones. The only difference between these 3 properties is the size of the text box displayed in the template tab of the object, and this is purely visual. The actual maximum amount of text is the same for all text properties and can be adjusted with the parameters. It is also possible to define invalid characters that should not be usable in the text, or to set a placeholder text. For examples of drop-down list and slot properties, we will switch to another feature. Click Cancel, then Confirm to leave the feature editor without saving any changes to this feature. Then select the feature called Dialog Fragment from the Tutorial folder and go to the feature editor again. In this feature, we have 1 property so far. It is a slot property called SoundFile. A slot property allows you to connect a specific file or object to the element with this template. It is a bit like the reference strip we have encountered in Video 4, the character creation, and Video 5, the flow. For a slot, we can define the allowed object types in the parameters. For this example, we want to use the slot property so we can assign a sound file to be played at a specific part of the dialogue. By allowing only the asset type sounds as input for the slot, we can prevent errors like accidentally linking an image or a video file. A strip is basically the same as a slot, but you can assign multiple files or objects at once. The drop-down list property provides an enumeration. Drag a drop-down list to the layout area now. We will use it to create a property for the selection of camera angles for dialogue lines. After placing the list editor opens automatically. Here we will enter the camera angles as list items. We will start with a medium shot entry, then add total, close-up and shoulder to round out the list. Click OK to close the list editor. If you want to add or edit something later, you can always open the editor again by clicking the Edit List button. Don't forget to select a telling name. I usually use the same term for display name and technical name, but of course without the spaces for the latter. Last thing we do is set a default value, so we do not have to set a camera angle later in each and every dialogue fragment, but only have to touch the elements where we want to deviate from the standard angle. The remaining property types are more advanced and go beyond the scope of this first step series. You can find additional information about all property types, including the more advanced ones, linked in the video description. Now save the changes to the feature by clicking Apply and then Confirm. We have arrived at the end of this lesson. We talked about the benefits of using templates, looked at how they are constructed, and updated a feature with an additional property. In the next video, we will learn how to assign a template to multiple objects at once, with the help of the query search, and use the property inspector to get an additional view on an object for faster editing. Thank you for joining us, and join us again in our next tutorial.